My cell phone probably wouldn't flip open if it weren't for the Star Trek communicator. But Star Trek has much more exciting technology, like the warp drive and the transporter and the holodeck. And the question is, which of these can become real?
In the last four decades, people all over this planet have come to know Star Trek as a science fiction staple. Its weekly fables of life and adventures in far-off galaxies have informed our imagination to what is possible and what is not. Set 300 years in the future, Star Trek is far enough away in time that the writers of the show could create ingenious ideas of travel, entertainment, and communication. After all, it was only 130 years ago that electricity became a reality, turning darkness into light. Since then, almost everything has changed in the modern world. That's why it's not hard for us to believe that one day we might be beaming ourselves from one place to another.
You know, walking around campus on a beautiful fall day is great. But when you're late for class is a problem. It would be great to have a transporter. And the transporter is, in fact, what seduced me into writing about Star Trek, because of all the fascinating physics I realized you'd have to think about if you wanted to move someone from one place to another almost instantaneously.
Energize.
The transporter is an ingenious storytelling device.
As much as I travel, I would really enjoy being able to beam from one place to another.
I'm interested in beaming, particularly. I'm waiting on that, huh? No more airplane, you know what I'm talking about? I can just go over there.
What's fascinating is imagining how something like this, if it were to, you know, to be created, how it would change the world. I mean, imagine having a world where you didn't have, you know, half the place paved over for freeways and cars, and you people could, you know, just jump, step into a machine and pop over here.
With airline travel the way it is today, you know, one would certainly wish it. On the other hand, you know, you sometimes get what you wish for and you end up like the fly.
I can still remember the day in Dr. Olufsen's transporter theory class when he was talking about the body being converted into billions of kiloquads of data zipping through subspace, and I realized there's no margin for error.
I think building a transporter would be a pretty tricky proposition.
One atom out of place and poof, you never come back.
To dematerialize someone, and I use that word literally, to dematerialize them, to take them apart on in a material sense, convert them into a stream of matter and energy, I think you would have to heat a person up to a temperature of something like 100 billion degrees in order to make that happen. Cannot imagine that that would be a pleasant experience. I don't care how advanced the technology is.
Teleportation in particular, I think, was a definite plot-saving device, but also it had existed in science fiction literature before that.
Gene Roddenberry knew that they couldn't afford to land on a planet every week. So, you know, what are we going to do? How are we going to get our people back and forth?
They didn't have the money to show a spacecraft going down to the planet. That animation took too much money, so they said, what are we going to do? How are we going to get the actors down to the planet? And Gene Roddenberry said, simple, we'll beam them down.
That was Roddenberry's genius.
There was an explanation given of sorts in an episode of the original series called The Savage Curtain. And Kirk actually, in a nutshell, explains transporter technology to sort of a replica of Abraham Lincoln, of all people.
What does the device use? An energy matter scrambler, sir. The molecules in your body are converted into energy, then beamed into this chamber and reconverted back into their original pattern.
Say you wanted to transport someone. Say you had a hapless subject and you wanted to transport him as far away as you could instantaneously. Well, the Star Trek writers tell you how you do that. You'd simply vaporize him and take his atoms and move them in a matter stream from here, way over there, then put the atoms together again, making another copy of him up there. However, I wouldn't do it that way. So I would scan him and make an entire copy of all the information that makes him up as a human being. And then I transport that information at the speed of light to wherever I wanted to place him, combine it with some atoms over there, making another copy of him. Of course, that's not a transporter because then he exists over there and over here. Well, that's very simple. I vaporize him. Now he's only over there.
All right, Mr. Scott, energize.
The University of Copenhagen is the birthplace of quantum physics, which is the fundamental basis of teleportation. Here, Niels Bohr, the father of quantum theory, and Werner Heisenberg, the father of quantum mechanics, perfected their ideas on this campus in the 1920s. Today, leading physicist Eugene Polzik works at the Niels Bohr Institute on quantum teleportation.
In this very classroom, on those very benches, the founding fathers of contemporary quantum physics got together, and you can see them actually here sitting on those very benches. Niels Bohr is here, Werner Heisenberg is next to him, and of course the Heisenberg compensator, for example, is exactly what can be attributed to quantum teleportation.
The thing that makes the transporter impossible is a fancy law of physics from quantum mechanics called the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. And it says, I can never tell exactly where each atom of your body is and what it's doing at the same time.
I run a scan on the Heisenberg compensators.
Oh no, Chief, you've done enough already.
That's no problem.
I designed the transporter control console for Star Trek The Next Generation. When I was labeling the subsystems for the transporter, I just labeled the button, Heisenberg compensator.
Gene Roddenberry, who created the original Star Trek, wanted to make sure that the show was believable. He felt that it needed, as much as possible, to be an extrapolation from real present-day science. So from the very beginning, he built that into the series and made sure that all of the technical aspects of the show were grounded in real science that we could imagine might happen in the future.
In order to teleport anyone, Spock for instance, from the Enterprise to Earth, you'll need atoms already on Earth to reconstruct him into a solid state. You'll also need to send information to the atoms on Earth on how to build Spock. Based on the theory of quantum teleportation, two pulses of light are needed to teleport Spock. Both pulses of light will leave the Enterprise at the same time. One pulse of light will pass through the atoms on Earth, entangling them, and then combine with the pulse of light carrying Spock's information. A precise calculation will be taken on a sensor machine, which will then beam back to the atoms, creating Spock.
Speculation is unnecessary, Captain. The answer is clear.
We have done teleportation of a pulse of light, which travels with the speed of light. What we have done can be viewed as one half of the Star Trek teleportation.
If you could take all the properties of your atoms and molecules over here and recreate them over there, those ideas are out there and people are toying with, well, how to make this happen and what are the critical issues?
It turns out if you do use those fancy laws of quantum mechanics, you could take individual atoms or individual particles of light and do precisely what the transporter does for humans.
Here we are, this is the quantum optics laboratory where the teleportation experiment actually takes place. The optical elements are used to shape the beam to be teleported that comes this way, and the beam which is entangled with atoms which come that way, and then the two beams are mixed here and measured by those detectors, and then through all those forest of cables the action is onto atoms where the teleportation ends.
Transporting really is the safest way to travel.
What we are teleporting actually is information. But this is the only substance that is worth teleporting.
A transporter may be possible someday. Probably not in our lifetimes. I don't think you should ever underestimate the power of human imagination and ingenuity.
With every generation of Star Trek, the battles for peace and diplomacy were hard fought against elusive and aggressive enemies. Advanced military devices such as cloaking, deflector shields, and photon torpedoes were the necessary hardware on the battlefields of space.
Here we are in a football stadium. What better place to talk about cloaking and deflection? For example, wouldn't it be great if you're in a football game to suddenly be cloaked and then be able to reappear on the other side of the defenders? With a cloaking device, what you're really doing is just ensuring that an individual or a machine is invisible.
One of the first episodes of the original Star Trek series was Balance of Terror, in which we first met the Romulans. The episode was basically a space version of a classic submarine movie.
Enterprise was the battleship on the surface, and the Romulan ship was the thing under the water that they were trying to find. And, you know, we'd toss off photon torpedoes, kind of like depth charges, you know, and try to ferret this thing out.
You could conceivably have some technology that allows light rays to bend around an object.
So that instead of bouncing off of you, it went around you. That would render you essentially invisible.
If something is here, and light comes and bends around it, you would see me, but you wouldn't see what's between it.
There are people today who have now developed these so-called metamaterials that have electrical and atomic properties that basically can do the same thing for a very, very narrow frequency of light, and in fact, in the radio part of the spectrum.
That sort of thing might evolve into someday into a Star Trek-style cloaking device.
A team of scientists at Duke University have been experimenting with a complex form of matter known as metamaterials. Its fundamental use is for technology, but a little experiment proved fruitful when the team discovered that it could be used as a cloaking device.
A metamaterial is an artificially structured material, and these are a couple of examples, and they don't look like materials in the sense that we normally think of, like a piece of glass or plastic.
Star Trek's cloaking device is complete invisibility. Unlike the Romulan warbird or the Klingon bird of prey, which could completely disappear, the metamaterial-style cloaking device works on various radiation waves and microwaves.
This is the main apparatus in which we've measured the cloaks. This is the cloak, and this material region is the cloaking region, and this central hole is where you hide something. So if the Enterprise were to be cloaked by this, it would have to fit into this hole. So we would put the cloak in the center of this region, and then we will close down these plates point by point, and we build up an image of what the microwaves are doing inside.
It's hard to sort of see what cloaking looks like since we don't see in microwaves, so these simulations help us both understand what should be happening and interpret the experiments and just give a nice view into how things actually work. These individual lines that you see here are actually the direction the energy is traveling, and there is a big reflection off of the front of it and also a very big shadow region cast behind it, and that's how you would be able to see this object if you could see it microwaved. Now what you see in contrast is outside the cloaking shell, the wave now has reverted back to what it looked like when empty space was everywhere. As far as any observer would be able to determine, there is nothing in this space.
Still a long way from building an actual Romulan-style cloaking device, but a first step.
From the strategic tactical advantage of the cloaking device to the defensive posture of the deflector shield, Star Trek's battlefield technologies were numerous.
Deflector shields are, of course, designed to protect the device by deflecting off any phaser beams or enemy photon torpedoes or things like that. Easier, however, than deflecting is simply absorbing. And nowadays, when people talk about protecting you from bullets, it's largely by absorption, be it a bulletproof vest or more sophisticated technologies such as plasma technologies that might surround some spacecraft which would absorb enemy laser beams or other kinds of radiation. Those technologies are realistic.
Space is a dangerous place. There's all kinds of people who want to zap you. Theoretically, the ship has something called a deflector beam that points ahead and just pushes things aside. Even the present-day space shuttle, when it's traveling at 17,000 miles an hour, so even if there's a little speck out there, it'll hit you at tremendous speed. The shuttle has had little holes in the window caused literally by flecks of paint.
It deals with high-energy plasma reactions.
Plasma is a key ingredient behind Star Trek's deflector shield technology. Professor Munir LaRussi at Old Dominion University has been researching plasma to further our understanding of how it could be used in defense for such operations as cloaking and deflector shields.
So here is a plasma. We just turned it on by applying electrical energy to it. If this was the Enterprise and you turn on the shield, the plasma is supposed to come and cover the spacecraft, have enough shield around it to protect it from either detection or from incoming high-power microwaves or high-powered weapons, if you like, to protect it from destruction. Plasma can play a role in protecting your spacecraft from other potentially enemy spacecraft.
Clearly, the military is interested in hiding from the enemy It's our soldiers, our airmen, our sailors are much better off if they're not visible.
This experiment is merely to show you that the plasma can wrap itself around metallic objects, and if the plasma is dense enough and thick enough, it can absorb a whole spectrum of microwave radiation. You can see that the plasma actually sticks to the metallic objects and form a sheath around them. When you form a sheath like this, that is for ingoing and outgoing signals. So it will be in kind of in a blackout.
The Enterprise not only used defensive mechanisms such as deflector shields, but was also equipped with offensive weapons such as phasers and photon torpedoes.
Weapons are ready, sir.
In Star Trek, photon torpedoes are nothing of the sort. They're really devices that take matter and antimatter and bring them together at the moment of impact, producing incredible bursts of radiation, photons, and the process destroying whatever around them. When we talk about directed energy weapons, now we're talking about phasers as well as photon torpedoes. Depending upon how you turn up the power in a phaser in Star Trek, it can go from stun to actually vaporizing someone.
Our ship's phasers will then blast and disintegrate it, proving we are dangerous.
Energy required to vaporize someone is so great that it's more than the power of thousands of nuclear weapons, first of all. But secondly, you notice there's no recoil. And if I was going to actually vaporize you and turn you into energy, the recoil would be enough to knock me to the other side of the Earth.
The mission of the Enterprise was to explore strange new worlds and to seek out new life, and we very much wanted to do that peacefully. But of course, we wanted to protect ourselves from people who might be hostile or who might misunderstand our intentions, and the sort of default setting on that phaser was the stun setting.
If you take one more step towards my son...
You don't want to kill somebody if you don't have to, obviously, but you want to have a way of protecting yourself if things get a little out of hand.
These are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Its continuing mission to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no one has gone before.
In high school physics, we teach that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. But that's not quite true. You have to be like a lawyer and parse that a little more carefully. Nothing can travel through space faster than the speed of light. But as far as we know, space itself can do whatever the heck it wants. It can expand and contract. And the equations of general relativity tell us that space is determined by the energy of everything within space. And once you allow space to be dynamical, then all bets are off.
Geordi, prepare warp dump.
There are no guarantees here, sir.
There never are, Lieutenant. I'm going to trust your expertise. Secure your stations.
When Gene created the original series in the mid-1960s, he wanted to explore the galaxy. He wanted to do a show that involved a starship that could travel from one star to another in the course of a week. Because he was doing a weekly TV show, he wanted to get the crew to a different planet every week to have a different adventure.
A nice vacation.
It was a nice place to visit, number one, but I wouldn't want to die there.
Space is so immense and so vast that there's no way you could tell a story, in my opinion, about getting across the galaxy without inventing something that we've been told doesn't exist anyway, that you can't go faster than the speed of light.
Absolutely incredible.
The nearest star to here is four light years away. That means if you traveled at the speed of light, it'd take you 4 years. You're not going to wait 4 years for the next episode. You know, the networks wouldn't allow it.
The very reason for the existence of our starships is contact with other life.
That's why warp drive was created. Warp drive was created so that we could go through vast distances in a shorter period of time.
Warp drive is really fast.
Launch commit, liftoff. We have liftoff 49 minutes past the hour.
In the 1960s, the race for space exploration between the Soviet Union and the United States pushed the envelope in flight technology. Since man first landed on the moon in the summer of 1969, nations have joined together in exploring the final frontier. One of the cornerstones of space exploration is NASA. And since 1958, America's space agency has been a global leader in boldly going where no man has gone before.
Welcome to NASA's Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio. We're in building 301, where they used to test ion thrusters, electric propulsion devices. An ion thruster is another type of rocket, but instead of using chemical energy, it uses electrical energy. This shows the insides of an ion thruster. Actually, this big one was done in the late 60s when they were seeing how far they could push the technology. In this chamber is where you'd create the plasma, a charged gas. And as the charged ions drifted past these two grids, which have a high voltage potential across them, they would be accelerated out at high speed. And when you're talking things like interstellar flight, this ion engine, as advanced as it is nowhere close to the capability of something like a warp drive.
Full impulse power, initiate Kuma maneuver.
Impulse drive is basically very much like present day rockets. It's what you use for slower than light travel, basically within a solar system. Faster than light travel is an order of magnitude faster, many orders of magnitude faster. And you need faster than light propulsion, which is a warp drive.
And the way it works is that even though there's a speed limit for how fast things can move through space-time, like say a speed limit for how fast I can move my finger across my hand, there's different rules governing how fast you can move space-time. And that's the idea of the warp drive, that you create an expanding region of space-time behind the vehicle and a collapsing region of space-time in front of the vehicle. And that creates this bubble of moving space-time that carries the vehicle with it at faster than light speeds.
Can you regulate the reaction?
The warp core is the heart of the ship's engines. It's where the ship creates something called warp plasma. Warp plasma is created by combining matter and antimatter through the facility of a thing called a dilithium crystal.
We should be able to do something with these dilithium fragments we scattered.
And that warp plasma is then channeled out into the engine nacelles, those two big pods that come off the back end of the ship.
Step on it.
One thing that's clear is it would take an immense amount of power. And one way to get an immense amount of power is there's something called antimatter. You take antimatter and slam it together with an equal quantity of regular matter, and that entire mass gets converted into pure energy. It's a lot of power.
There's no antimatter to fuel the drive.
What antimatter is, it's matter with its electrical charge reversed. And when antimatter and matter meet, they annihilate each other, giving off lots of energy. In Star Trek, they use antimatter to power their warp drives, where they would take antimatter and matter and capture all that energy as a reaction.
Is there a danger of detonation?
I believe antimatter probably exists, but if we were to touch it, there would be this cataclysmic explosion.
Now, what are the possibilities of warp drive?
Not good.
We can't tell you, of course, how to build a warp drive. Nobody knows how to do it. If we knew how to do that, we'd be geniuses.
People know that there's something that's possible called warp drive, and you can tell them in all sorts of ways that it's, you know, through physics, impossible. But they'll just say that's the physics we know now. Another species or another, that's the limits of our knowledge. This might be, it's probably superior intelligence, and it can get here in 5 minutes.
I'd love to take a ride in space. Huh? Absolutely. I don't think it's far from being quite possible.
I wish we were further along than we are now. I think that we as a race, as a planet, we are compelled to explore. It's just part of our genetics.
We always, as a nation, as human beings, had a nature to explore, an innate desire to explore. It's one of the reasons that Columbus crossed the sea to come to America. That's what we're doing now with the exploration program. In fact, that's what's happening in Star Trek and on the science fiction program. They're off exploring new worlds. We're off to explore a new world when we aim to go to Mars.
Just the desire for not just even the new, but the other, the what we haven't thought of yet, where we haven't been yet, what we haven't dreamed yet and imagined yet. And I think science fiction as a genre is really focused on presenting that those questions and answering them provisionally.
We have discovered something which may explain Data's beginnings.
Artificial intelligence. In my opinion, this is one of the more realistic aspects of Star Trek.
Actually, I'm quite deficient in some basic human information.
Right now, computers can't think. They're not as complex as the human brain. But they've been evolving at an exponential rate over the last 20 years. We don't know at what level of complexity a device has to work before it's conscious.
We are merely a different variety of machine. In our case, electrochemical in nature.
Somewhere between these computers and our brain is a device that I think will think.
A good starting point may be, why was I given human form?
Data is kind of like the ultimate user-friendly computer.
He wanted to be human. I mean, he was created as an artificial form of intelligence, but what he really wanted to be was human.
If you had an off switch, Doctor, would you not keep it secret?
Data was an interesting character because he was an outsider. He could, you know, as a storytelling device, be used to comment on humanity. He aspired to be human. He was essentially Pinocchio.
I also find sneezing interesting.
Chew!
What is it to be a human being? What does it take? Is it just copying behavior? Or is there something else? That's an incredible philosophical question.
The reality of robots as realistic as those on Star Trek might still be in the distant future. However, with advancements in technology, robotics have improved exponentially over the last few decades. Multinational companies and leading universities have pushed the envelope with artificial intelligence. Today, experiments in movement and motor skills are refining what we can expect in the near future.
Hi, I am Grace.
This is Grace. This is a robot that we developed for a mobile robot competition where the robot was supposed to interact with people and find its way to through a convention center. It's built on a commercial platform, and we've added the face and cameras and other sensors to get it to be able to detect people and interact with people. The main features that it has is, as I said, this graphical face, which is very expressive. It can do emotions and look sad or happy, whatever.
Fascinating.
It was interesting the way in the Star Trek series they captured some of what Commander Data would be going through. Here's a machine trying to interact in a human world. The robotics cannot capture the soul of a human being.
Quite true. I keep trying to be more human and keep failing.
The character of Data represents one of the most timeless questions in science fiction and in literature. What is it to be human? He's incredibly sophisticated. As far as we can tell, he has genuine emotions. But is he human?
I can appear happy or sad, flirtatious.
Can we make a realistic robot now? I don't think so. 100, 200 years from now, I would be willing to wager that we could.
Number one, have you ever considered whether Data is more human or less human than we want?
I only wish we were all as well balanced, sir.
Agreed.
Robots and androids living amongst us might make for great science fiction, but one day, it's sure to be a reality. Today on planet Earth, many of us rely on devices that have indeed been inspired by Star Trek. One gadget used heavily in the Star Trek franchise was the tricorder, a device used for monitoring, mapping, and even medical uses.
A tricorder is a portable scientific instrument that if you're going on a scientific mission to study a planet or to investigate some phenomenon, or even troubleshooting on the ship, it's a handy, user-friendly gizmo that basically gives you all the tools you need right there.
Tricorders are great instruments that can tell you almost anything you want to know about a particular item. And it could be anything from geology to biology. Tricorders are great. I wish I had one.
Like so many Star Trek technologies at the time it was, the tricorder was first seen. It seemed incredibly advanced. Nowadays, you're just getting a camcorder.
It has a lot of the functions that an old tricorder used to have.
You're basically talking about a very portable, you know, little computer device that can scan the area around it for, and that to me seems like we've already got something like that.
You have a PDA, you have a BlackBerry that gives you this access to these computer databases and connectivity. So a lot of these things are exist in some form. You know,
MIT professor Joe Paradiso has designed a modern-day style tricorder. His idea is based on tiny sensors already in place, so that when you arrive somewhere, your tricorder device will tell you temperature, air quality, and give you an accurate map of the area.
This device is what we call right now the tricorder, and it is really inspired by the Star Trek tricorder. As I'm walking with it, it's tracking my position and moving a map of the building around. I'm looking at data represented from all the sensor nodes we have scattered around this floor of the building. We can see some motion in a node over here in the back of there's an office in the back of that wall.
Continue on into closed parking orbit.
Roddenberry would suggest these things, these warp drive or tricorders or biomedical diagnostic beds. He would show them on camera, not necessarily showing them in any great detail, but the wonderful thing is it inspired people. People to say, yeah, you know, that would be a great thing to have in a real hospital. How can you do that?
I read in the paper the other day that they're working on a machine that issues out an electric current that makes wounds heal that much faster, which is close to what the tricorder can do.
Focused on the medical applications of the tricorder, Dr. Rich Nucitelli of Old Dominion University has been experimenting with a device that speeds the process of human healing through the use of bioelectrics and plasma currents.
Well, this device is one that we call the bioelectric field imager that actually scans a probe over a 1 centimeter distance on your skin.
I'll run a microcellular scan of Mr. Barclay's arm. It might take some time, but if there's a problem, I'll find it.
This thing scans over the wound, measures the electric field, and then we would have another device that would enhance that field to stimulate wound healing of that wound. We have demonstrated in animals, again, that you can enhance the rate of wound healing with an electric field. Again, nothing in human yet.
Dr. Munir LaRussi has been experimenting with an instrument that uses plasma to heal wounds.
The plasma is a fourth state of matter, so it's been around since the world was created. This is a device that is able to emit a long plume, we call that a plume of plasma. It's kind of a beam that shoots out of ionized gas. Now this device, Dr. McCoy would have loved to have it on the Enterprise because this plume is able to actually inactivate or kill bacteria that can infect wounds or burns.
We don't get him to sick bay. He will die.
A lot of things that people have seen in Star Trek have inspired engineers, scientists, doctors to try to create. And so that's another great thing about Star Trek, is that it inspires people to do things.
I'm entering the ship's holodeck, where images of reality can be created by our computer. Highly useful in crew training. Highly enjoyable when used for games and recreation.
The holodeck is actually one of the more realistic aspects of Star Trek. It's really the natural continuation of something that's going on right now, virtual reality.
Virtual reality technology was becoming something of an issue and gaining some prominence in the 1980s, and Gene thought, hey, what would the ultimate virtual reality experience be like? Well, totally immersive.
The holodeck is short for Holographic Environment Simulator. It's a room in which you can recreate any environment, any setting, any person.
They were trying to figure out a way of making the Enterprise D homier, because that is where you live.
One of the thoughts is that you'd have a big wall-sized television. I think that eventually led to the concept that maybe it could become an immersive environment.
For us as writers, it was a way that we could do a period piece Sherlock Holmes story or some sort of fantasy planet or place that we hadn't created, or go back to somebody's home when they were in the middle of space.
Program desired location.
Earth, United States, San Francisco, California.
Time period?
1941 AD.
Imagine the kinds of video games that people play today, times a thousand, where you're truly immersed in an artificial environment of your own creation, and it, for all intents and purposes, feels absolutely real.
The characters I'll meet are generated by the computer, of course, yet they feel real. They seem real in every way.
One of the first times we ever saw the holodeck in Star Trek The Next Generation was an episode where they used it for Aikido training. So all you had is these figures and Aikido gis. So I was very simplistic. One of the next times we saw the holodeck was an episode called The Big Goodbye, where they recreated the world of gumshoe detective Dixon Hill.
I am not Dixon Hill. I just look like Dixon Hill.
It was a great storytelling device, and of course, there's always the classic holodeck malfunction.
I can't find the captain, sir.
I told you he's in the holodeck.
I'm at the holodeck. Something's gone wrong.
It actually was a visionary thing that Gene Roddenberry came up with.
That's when we're able to open our eyes and see things as they really could be.
You'll have to call again. I'm just leaving. I'm not dressed properly. I'll be back.
Holodeck always worried me, though, because if you found an environment that you really liked, why would you leave?
What a great playground, right?
You would absolutely never move from one spot.
To explain this immersive 3D environment further, we must first enter the holodeck. Once inside, the holodeck appears as just one large room with four walls, a ceiling, and a floor. But it's the computerized grid that covers the entire room that you notice first. The grid acts as a skin, and it's within the skin that makes up the building blocks of the holodeck. Millions of tiny omnidirectional hollow diodes create the effects of the virtual environment. Each diode can project full-color stereoscopic images that make up the real-life look of the holodeck. But it's the manipulated force fields that allow each image to come to life. The force fields allow a visitor to feel objects that aren't really there. A Starfleet officer can program the holodeck to display any environment he or she wants, as long as the computer already has the simulation in memory.
Captain, you need the diversion.
Dixon Hill.
The program's installed and waiting.
So in the holodeck, we have various kinds of components, these omnidirectional holographic diodes, the holographic arrays, the projector arrays, the force field generators, the replicators, the matter energy replicators. All of that technology, in some way that for us seems like magic, goes into the creation of this extraordinary technology called the holodeck.
The holodeck is perhaps the greatest entertainment apparatus invented, as it allows the person who enters it to be transformed to another time and place in history, and to interact with real-life people. Inside the holodeck, one could have lunch with a president, take a maiden voyage on a sailing ship, or witness a piece of history.
It's based on the idea of holograms, which are certainly realistic. They're three-dimensional images.
Where we are with holograms today is that holography is, for still images, is very, very well developed. It's like high-quality photography, and it gives this additional richness. Holographic television, on the other hand, is about where ordinary television was in the 1930s.
At the forefront of immersive virtual reality is Professor Rachel Brady at Duke University.
What I'm interested in is how can we interact and look at three-dimensional data in a more natural way. So I wrote a proposal and built the Dive, the Duke Immersive Virtual Environment, which allows us to interact and look at 3D data in three dimensions. Each wall has a projector sending the image to it, which is bouncing off this mirror so that we can get a big enough image to cover the whole wall without having to have such a big room. So this application is a way to study deep brain anatomy. We have an MRI of a human brain, and we have difficulty in looking at how the structures intercorrelate with each other. So we can take this MRI slice and pull it towards the 3D structure and see how it intersects with the MRI.
I'm rather optimistic eventually about our being able to make very, very rich spaces with three-dimensional objects moving around in them.
We're a little bit away from actually implementing the holodeck because we have no sense of touch.
Maybe we should be getting back to the Enterprise.
We are on the Enterprise.
Oh, yes. Of course, here we are.
You could imagine anything and have these fantasy adventures, and quite a number of the different Star Treks use the holodeck to put us into different periods.
Gene thought, hey, you know, if we're going to do the holodeck, let's do it big time. Let's really make this the ultimate immersive reality. There were, from the point of view of the user, there seemed to be no limits. Even though you're surrounded by four walls, you can never get to them because the landscape keeps receding and that little treadmill under the feet makes sure that you're not really moving relative to the actual walls. It just seems that way.
Right now, we don't know how to put light in the air such that you bump into it and you feel it. And we don't know how to make light go out halfway across the room and make a U-turn and come back without having something there for it to reflect from.
The point is not so much could these things be realized, but that the imagination itself can play and think ahead. And that will produce new things, new ideas in the real world.
There are some physics principles that are to some degree at odds with what you'd like the holodeck to do.
Memory, save current setting.
Current setting saved.
Holodeck off.
Immersive virtual reality environments are certainly, part of amusement parks as well as research parks.
The science behind the holodeck is pretty shaky. It doesn't really, it's not really there, bending proto-matter and things like that. Those are words that were made up for the series. But just as in teleportation and as in warp drive, who knows what we'll end up with.
Holography right now is like a window, which is to say that maybe Picard could look at this window and see some virtual scene behind it, but he can't step through the window and be in the room with those objects. And in order to do the holodeck, we have to solve that problem also.
Exit.
The holodeck world of Star Trek, in the sense of having a virtual reality that you live in, is not that far off. It's certainly not as far off as the 24th century.
There are many things that Star Trek just stumbled upon and created that now really do exist.
Science fiction is not so much fiction as it truly is our imagination meeting our love of science.
Science fiction, becomes reality when reality catches up with science fiction.
It is amazing to me that many of the things that Star Trek has invented, they either exist or they're very close to existing.
We will never know it all. We will never arrive. There is no place to arrive. It is truly about the journey, and the journey is eternal.
And the fact that Star Trek took that huge leap of faith to try to push in that direction, it's stimulating in and of itself. They got a lot right, they got some stuff wrong, but it was okay. It made for a really good series and movies.
Star Trek offers us a vision of a future full of possibilities. Whether these possibilities are realized or not remains to be seen. Some are outlandish, some might be right around the corner. But one thing is certain, science is continuing to progress at an incredible rate, and nature continues to surprise us in ways that no science fiction writer has ever dreamed of. So it is true now, and it will be true in the 23rd century. Truth will remain stranger than fiction.